the mountain bike. Identifiable through its handlebar and front yoke design, used often by the Midwest child due to its greater road contact surface and coefficient of friction, the safer option than the thinner tires of the road bike, but still an upgrade afforded to the 1990s preteen, a rite of passage my family and I went through as kids in the 2000s. A bike on the streets of Hamilton County, Ohio, the ideal transportation for an undercover child, spy, person. But we're not here to talk about bicycles. Well, I guess that wouldn't be completely true, but where to begin? And how do I make this video with as little spoilers to Black Widow as possible? After maybe the most tear-jerking opening credits of a Marvel film, we get introduced to the setting of a widow on the run. In parallel, another widow learns the truth of her circumstances and is also trying to evade capture. A villainous cyborg is sent after a MacGuffin, and the two widows become caught in the crossfire. Natasha finds herself in Norway, Yelena in Budapest.
Budapest.
On the run, Natasha goes off-grid, contracting the services of Rick Mason and acquiring both a tucked-away trailer home and the Lada 4x4 Urban, a Range Rover-styled vehicle for the non-Scandinavian viewer, an ideal vehicle to fit into that province's road population while also providing the capability of traversing the backroads and country trails to the poorly furnished safe house. In the more personal moments of Natasha Romanoff's journeys of solitude, the moments in her history when she is truly the undercover assassin, these criteria are consistently met. The vehicles are inconspicuous, yet purposeful. They perform the mission, and in this case, the mission is to lay low. In the more publicly documented moments of her heroic career, her vehicles become just as dramatic. The Quinjets throughout the MCU, fictional troop carriers. The Harley-Davidson in Age of Ultron, a hot new prototype. The Corvette Stingray from The Winter Soldier, a moment of stellar beauty on the otherwise drab highways of the American Northeast Coast. Her time in undercover missions, her vehicles capable, yet hidden. Her time as the Avenger, again capable vehicles, but this time without the need for concealment. But before we get into that, I wanted to spend no more than 2 minutes and offer a discussion of the Marvel Cinematic Universe's use of cars versus motorcycles. Right at the beginning of the MCU, the relationship between Audi and Tony Stark was established. I've covered this in my video of the Audi RS e-tron GT. Phase 1 continues with a variant Bruce Banner purchasing a used truck with cash, Thor's team using their cozy camper, and then Captain America on the classically outfitted Harley-Davidson Softail, a model he rides off toward the sunset on in Avengers Assemble. We run the full gambit of smartly chosen vehicles in Phase 1. Only for it to end with Mark Ruffalo-Hulk entering the Battle of New York on a poorly puttering Triumph Daytona, and Tony Stark leaving the Battle of New York on the obviously not Audi Acura NSX concept vehicle. Steve Rogers has the biggest history with Harley-Davidson, being featured as early as 1944 in his serial film and later on in his comic books. Captain America likes his Harleys, and as previously mentioned, he rides them in his movie appearances too, continuing to feature the Softail in The Winter Soldier, only trading it in for a Street 750 to escape from a Hydra-led SHIELD headquarters, before realizing, hey, this Street 750 is pretty nice, and hanging onto it. Except this time, instead of running away from Hydra, it's breaking into the final Hydra outpost in Age of Ultron. Fun fact, Bucky steals this same model in his chase from Steve Rogers and King T'Challa in Civil War. Natasha Romanoff has a comic and merchandise history with motorcycles too, except it's of a more sexualized nature. And while producers as well as Scarlett Johansson have called into accountability the early representations of the character on screen, the second half of her decade as the character has been a much more focused and grounded interpretation. But I'm a man, and you didn't come here for me to talk about feminism in the movie industry.
Well, damn, Jackie, I can't control the weather!
Harley-Davidson has been maybe the least publicized relationship when it comes to auto manufacturers and Marvel Studios. Marvel makes good on most relationships by producing marketing material for automotive companies like Lexus and Audi whenever they feature them in an MCU film. But Harley has been in the inner circles of Marvel's brand recognition since 2011. It's biggest brand recognition probably during Steve Rogers' relaxed ride from S.H.I.E.L.D. headquarters. Even so, it was no surprise that when the Age of Ultron script was finished, they turned to Harley Davidson. In a way, this was their only opportunity within the MCU at getting the kind of brand marketing that is as recognized as those Spider-Man and Audi commercials. When they read the scene, which required a motorcycle to drop from a Quinjet, they immediately thought of the Livewire. This motorcycle is the first true halo vehicle this company has produced for many years, and this movie became a way to gauge the market for a highly technological electric superbike. Companies like Mission Motors and Zero Motorcycles had been in on the electric bike game for years. Mission Motors even went so far as to supply the powertrain to Harley-Davidson for the Livewire concept, but this was really the first true global test of market reaction. Harley offered the Livewire as an option to the studio. Marvel asked for four of them. Since that time, advancements between the prototype and 2020 model, released in 2019, have rendered the decision to include the Livewire as an enlightened choice. While the production model touts 105 horsepower and 86 pound-feet of torque, with a new powertrain developed in-house, I wouldn't be doing any favors by talking about a vehicle that wouldn't have been released in-universe for the movie. I received a bit of flack after claiming the e-tron GT in Endgame is a 2022 RS model. Comments said, it's a prototype, not the 2022 model. And while I, of course, know that, and went through an entire week doing the research, it's still something to comment on. And if those comments made them happier, who am I to refuse them?
I stand behind it. I guarantee it.
What I go for in my videos is, what is the model used? And what was it made to be on the screen? For example, while the two Blazers who played Hopper's vehicle in Stranger Things were a 1983 and 1987 model, they were modified to look like a 1980 model. While Endgame was filmed from 2017 to 2018, and the production model for 2022 wasn't released until 2021, the movie is set in the year 2023, which is why I identify Tony's Audi RS e-tron GT a 2022 model year. A more drawn-out diversion from Black Widow, but I hope that explains why only the prototype numbers matter here. With the supplied powertrain from Mission Motors, the Livewire prototype only had 74 horsepower and 52 pound-feet of torque at its disposal. This is comparable to Harley-Davidson's most base model bike, the 883 Iron. Less power at 49 horses, but 54 available pound-feet of torque. Not surprising, considering electric motors tend to have a stronger power curve. Through the asphalt streets of Seoul, South Korea, this vehicle does the job of pursuing the Vision's body aboard Ultron's Daewoo Novus. It's such a brilliant choice not only for the relationship between Harley and Marvel, a relationship that has continued on through Captain Marvel, but also because it introduces electric vehicles into the superhero genre, dipping the toes before plunging in with the Audi e-tron and e-tron GT on screen post-2018. When it comes to Black Widow's motorcycle, well, really Yelena's motorcycle, we get introduced to a whole new bike entirely in the MCU. The Softail has been customized, more of a modified for off-road use cruiser. The Street 750 stays on asphalt as an intimidating rumbler. The Livewire is an entry into the realm of Superbike, but the CCM Spitfire Scrambler is a scrambler, a bike that's hard to define. Put simply, the Scrambler has higher ride height, meaning it's higher off the ground, allowing for increased suspension and greater terrain diversity. Budapest?
No, it's Budapest.
With its historic mixture of concrete, asphalt, cobblestones, and stairs, is a playground for the Scrambler motorcycle. Its pursuer, riding on a custom KTM, a brand known for off-road racing and stunts. Two well-positioned vehicles for the environment. Whereas in Age of Ultron, with only an asphalt road type, the superbike made greater sense. There's some hills and cornering, normal variation for that kind of bike, but unfortunately there's the inexplicable stair ramp, and I've got nothing for you there. Those would theoretically exist in real life, but they're not the 1-12 slope required for ADA compliance, so more likely it would be for luggage, but I can't find them anywhere. If you know what these are designed for outside of the MCU, let me know. CCM is a new brand for many in the riding industry. An acronym for Clues Competition Machines, the company was formed by Alan Clues after finding success on the weekend scrambler race circuit. These are fast, bare-bones bikes for aggressive driving. To feature this brand, and coincidentally having this particular model sold out at the time of the film's release, is a really impressive market strategy. Now branded as the exclusive motorcycle for a pair of superheroes, the demand for this bike should see a good climb. Yes, the Spitfire Scrambler is sold out. Coincidentally, Marvel asked for 6 during principal photography. As far as this particular stunt scene goes, it's an insanely crafted chase reminiscent of the visceral spy movie chases found in the Bourne or 007 franchise. The stunt coordinator wanted the progression of the foot chase to bike chase to car chase, and it played very naturally on screen. Coming right after the fight and reluctant apathy between the two sisters, the choreographer put these two in a situation of forced trust and close contact to progress the once severed bond between Natasha and Yelena. Astride the 55-horsepower motorcycle, with 40 pound-feet of torque available, they quickly found a playful banter common at the heart of so many Marvel teams.
Put your seatbelts on.
She's such a mom.
Marvel Studios has some great hits when it comes to cinematic design, and sometimes they'll have their misses. I think they've done a greater job in Phase 3 specifically at being conscientious with their featured cars. Doctor Strange's crash was very selective, being the only Lamborghini Huracan in the MCU. Ant-Man and the Wasp's wheel of die-cast cars paid playful homage to many of the characters' tastes. Captain Marvel, such a nostalgia trip. But when it came time for Black Widow's Phase 4 origin, she had the benefit of the groundwork laid from Phase 1 to 3. When she needed to enter stealth mode, she could comfortably drive the Overlander. When she needed Old City capability, she could ride the Scrambler. Is this the right vehicle for the character? For the Livewire, it's a yes. For the Scrambler, it's a much more enthusiastic yes. And in watching the entire Black Widow saga, I couldn't find an example that I didn't like. But I think there's more to this question. With Tony Stark, a motorcycle would seem off-brand. With Bruce Banner, it's a quirky stretch to see him entering the Battle of New York upon a metal steed. And so, more generically, are motorcycles the right vehicle for the Black Widow? I love this intimately told story. When we first meet young Natasha on the street of Ohio, she's on her bike. A relaxed, midsummer stroll on a bike meant for more adventure. By the end of that day, she's flying her first plane, on a mission to save her family. And in the last scene, she once again enters on her bike, this time a BMW R9T Scrambler. A relaxed posture, she dismounts, sheds her helmet, and takes off, once again flying away to try and save her family. Bikes suit her well, but then again, what doesn't? Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one.